Hello friends, in this video we will be learning more properties and also we will solve some numerical based on Fourier transform. Let us begin. So we'll start with a triangular function. So this triangular function is quite new for you. So I'll explain you how to express the triangular function mathematically. So a standard triangular function mathematically expressed as a triangular, TRI stands for a triangular function, TY, capital T. So now I'll tell you what is the significance of A and capital T. So remember, this A stands for height of the triangle. And this capital T indicates half width of the triangle. Small t indicates it is a function of time. And of course, when I write TRI, it means it is a triangular function. So I'm sure now you have understood what is exactly meant by a triangular function. So this is a mathematical expression. Let me draw this. For example, as you can see, capital T is the half width, then it will start from minus T by 2 to T by 2 around 0, and height of this triangle will be equal to T. So this is a graphical representation of the mathematically expressed triangular function. So now let's see and try to express. There are two samples I have taken, the first one and the second one, and I'll try to express them in terms of a mathematical expression. So here, by comparing with the standard function, A is equal to 1. And if you see a total width, this is twice of T. Assuming this is 0. So now I can write this as A triangular T by. Now we have to express only half width of it. So when I say 2T is a complete width, then half width would be, I'm sure now it is very simple for you. So now I would request you to pause the video and write a mathematical expression for the second sample triangle I have given and then confirm with my answer. So I'm sure you must have tried. So here, height of the triangle is 5. And if you see a total width of the triangle or base of the triangle, it is 12. Am I right? So now I can express this as A equal to 5 and total width equal to 12. So half width becomes 6. So now I can write this as 5 triangular function of T by. Now I have to write only half width. So half width is 6. So this is how we express a triangular function. So why we have learned this triangular function? We require it in case of a Fourier transform. So we'll see. So here, I have to perform a convolution and also I have to get a respective Fourier transform. So we'll see how. So as you can see, I have to convolve two signals. Let me assume this as x1 of t and this signal is x2 of t. After convolving, I'll be getting some other signal. Let us say y of t. So here I'll draw y of t graphically. So you must have observed that x1 of t and x2 of t are basically gate functions and both of them are having equal widths. So if you remember, whenever we convolve two rectangular functions of equal width, it gives you a triangle. And also, whenever we convolve two rectangular pulses of unequal width, then after convolution, it gives you what? A trapezoidal. Am I right? So here, since both the rectangular functions which are being convolved having equal width, therefore it is definitely going to give me a triangle. So the question is, from which point it is going to start? So you know that a starting point, that is lower limit of y of t, is lower limit for this plus lower limit for this. So minus t by 2 plus minus t by 2 will give you minus t. Also, it is going to end, that is higher limit of y of t after convolving is higher limit of first signal plus higher limit of the second signal. So capital T by 2 plus capital T by 2 will give me capital T. So now here I got a lower limit and higher limit of signal y of t, which is going to come after convolution of x1 of t and x2 of t. So now, since I know it is a triangle, let me draw a final triangle here. Now, to know height of the triangle, I should know what is the slope. So you know that slope of the growing line as well as the line which is going down will be equal and opposite to each other, because the line which goes upward has a positive slope, the line which goes downward will have a negative slope, but magnitude of both the slope will be equal to same, and that is always equal to amplitude of first signal multiplied by amplitude of the second signal. I repeat, slope is always equal to amplitude of the first signal multiplied by amplitude of the second signal. So as you can see, amplitude of the first signal is 1, amplitude of the second signal is also 1, take a product of it, it becomes 1. So 1 is a slope of the growing line, and minus 1 will be the slope of the line which is going down. So this is 0. So what is meant by slope equal to 1? That is, change in y and change in x will be equal to 1. For example, here, as you can see, x is changed by unit t, then y will also changed by same unit t, and then only I can say slope equal to 1. So one thing is very clear, that after convolving, the triangle that I have got is having height equal to t and width equal to 2t. I repeat, height equal to t and width equal to twice of t. You can observe over here, the total width over here is 2t, and height, here you can observe it is t. Is it right? So since I have convolved and I got some answer, this is a graphical representation. Let us express them in terms of a mathematics. So let us mathematically express this. So you know that it is a rectangular function. A standard rectangular function is given as a rect of t by capital T, where t is a complete width, a is height of the rectangle. So height of rectangle is 1, so it is just a rect of t by. Now, if you see a total width, it is t. Is that right? So it is going to get convolved with the same rectangular function. So it is rect of t by capital T. And after doing so, you got a triangular function as output. So as you can see now, it is t triangular t by. Now we write only half width, so if you see a total width, it is twice of t, half width is t. Is that right? So this is our final answer. So we have convolved and we got answer in terms of a time domain, but this is only half work done because we have performed only convolution. The second part is left. We have to get a Fourier transform of the same. So let us try to get a Fourier transform of the same. How do we take a Fourier transform of a rectangular function? You know that a Fourier transform of the rectangular function is always a sampling function. Am I right? And of course, it will be in terms of omega. Now, coefficient of this sampling function, that is a maximum value of the sampling function, is always area of the given rectangle. So here, if you see area of the given rectangle, so when I'm talking about x1 of t, your area will be calculated as length into breadth. So if you see a length, it is t, and width, it is 1. So area is t itself. So I would say area is t sampling. Of course, it is function of omega after having a Fourier transform, and coefficient of omega is always a half width of the given rectangle. So if you see a total width, it is t. So half width is omega t by 2. Am I right? So t by 2 is half width. And of course, since we have a same rectangular function which is getting convolved, so Fourier transform is not going to change. It will be t sampling function of omega t by 2. So we know that convolution in time domain, in frequency, it is just a multiplication. Am I right? So whenever you multiply this, what you are supposed to get? So after multiplying these two, what I'm supposed to get is t square sampling square omega t by 2. Am I right? So I'll take this as final result and I'll process on this. So what I got is rectangular function of t by t. When I try to convolve with rectangular function of t by t, what I've got is t triangular function of t by t. And in frequency domain, for this, what I got is t sampling function of omega t by 2. Convolution has become multiplication in frequency domain. Again, Fourier transform of this, I got t sampling function of omega t by 2, t square sampling square omega t by 2. Is that right? So finally, I can write t triangular function of t by capital T has a Fourier transform as t square sampling square omega t by 2. So here, as you can see, this capital T and this T gets cancelled. What is remaining is triangular function of T by capital T has a Fourier transform equal to T times sampling square omega T by 2. So whenever you come across a triangular function, and let's say if you want to take a Fourier transform of it, then we can remember this as a final result. And of course, I'll give you a trick to remember this as a final result. So how we can remember this? Let us see. So if you remember, a standard triangular function is written like this: a triangular of t by capital T, where a is what? It is height. And what is capital T? It is nothing but half width. So my question is, from this given triangular function, when I'm saying if nothing is there, I can say coefficient is 1. So height of this triangle is 1 and width of this triangle is twice of t, because what we write over here is only half width. So I can express my triangle this way: from minus t to plus t with height equal to 1 has got a Fourier transform of t times sampling square omega t by 2. So if you observe, what we have over here is nothing but area of the triangle. You can observe area of the triangle is nothing but half into base into height. Is that right? So it is half into what is base? So if you observe, base is twice of t into what? Height, and height is 1. So this 2 and 2 gets cancelled. What is area of the triangle? It is t. So what we have over here is area of the triangle. And naturally, whenever you have a Fourier transform, you have a function of omega. Now, the thing is, we have to take care of this coefficient. So after observing, you will understand this. A coefficient of omega is always a quarter width of the triangle. I repeat, coefficient of omega is always a quarter width of the given triangle. So if you see, what is the total width of the triangle? It is twice of t. So if you divide twice of t by 4, you will get capital T by 2 as a quarter width of the triangle. So this is how you can remember a final answer for a triangular function if you want to take a Fourier transform of it. So remember, rectangular function, when I'm talking about, its Fourier transform is sampling function. If I take a Fourier transform of the triangular function, then a Fourier transform of the triangular function is sampling square function. In this, the maximum amplitude of that sampling square function is nothing but area of the triangle. Naturally, a sampling square function will be a function of omega. Then the coefficient of omega is nothing but a quarter width of the given triangle. In this case, the width of the triangle was twice of t, and if you take a quarter width of it, it would be t by 2. Let's see how we get a Fourier transform for this. So 3 triangular function of t by 2, what does that mean? This 3 is nothing but height, and this 2 is nothing but half width. So I can draw the triangle graphically this way. Height of the triangle is 3. Width of the triangle is 4. Am I right? So here, height of the triangle is 3 and width of the triangle is 4. Now, if I have to take a Fourier transform, you know very well, Fourier transform of any triangular function is always a sampling square function. A sampling square function, which is function of omega. So now, two things I have to decide. A maximum amplitude here, as well as a coefficient of omega. So you know that a maximum amplitude of sampling square function is always area of the triangle. So it is half into base into height. So look at the base, it is 4 and height is 3. So it becomes total 6. Is it right? So what we have over here is 6. Now the thing is, we have to take a coefficient of omega. A coefficient of omega is always a quarter width of triangle. So if you see a width over here, it is 4. So 4 divided by 4 is 1. So finally, I can write it is simply 6 sampling square of omega. So this is a final Fourier transform for a given triangle. So I request you to pause the video and try to get a 5 triangular T by 3 Fourier transform and see to it whether you are going in a right path. So I'm sure you must have tried. So this 5 is height and this 3 is a half width. Graphically, I can show it like this. Height is 5 and width is 6. So this is a complete width 6. Of course, Fourier transform for any triangular function is sampling square function, which is naturally a function of omega. So we have to fill two places, that is a maximum amplitude of sampling square function as well as coefficient of omega. So maximum amplitude of sampling square function is nothing but area of the triangle, which is half into base into height. So it is half into, what is base? It is 6 and height is 5. So 2 3s are 6 and 3 5s are 15. So what we have over here, coefficient as 15. And then coefficient of omega is nothing but a quarter width of the triangle. So total width is 6. So coefficient of omega is 6 by 4. Or I can write this as 3 by 2. Finally, I can write a Fourier transform answer as 15 times sampling square of 3 omega by 2. So this becomes a final answer. So I'm sure you're quite confident to take a Fourier transform for any triangular function, right? Let's move ahead. So now we have a question. A signal is represented by, so they have given a mathematical expression for x of t from which we can guess what is a graphical representation. And then we have to take a Fourier transform of convolved signal y of t, where y of t is x of 2t convolved with x of t by 2. And then we have to find a final answer. So first of all, concentrate on the given data. So what it says, x of t is equal to 1 for mod of t less than 1 and it is 0 otherwise. So now I'll tell you how to identify. So now I'll tell you how to decode the meaning of mod of t. Please understand it very well. Just pay attention, listen to me, it is very helpful for you. See to it. Remember, if you want to decode the meaning of mod of t, you have to take two cases, that is t greater than 0 and t less than 0. Is that right? So when I'm saying for t greater than 0, replace mod t with positive t and see, it is very easy to remember. T greater than 0, it means positive values of t. So whenever I'm talking about positive values of t, treat mod of t means positive t. So there should not be any confusion in the notation. So treat mod of t as t only. But whenever I'm saying for t less than 0, then please treat mod of t as minus t. So you have to do only these things. Mod of t should be treated as positive t for t greater than 0. And for t less than 0, treat mod of t as minus t. And now let us try to decode. See. First of all, I'm talking about t greater than 0. So for t greater than 0, I'll write x of t is always 1 for Now mod of t should be replaced with positive t. So I would say t less than 1. I hope the definition is quite clear. Now for t less than 0, I'm going to define. Again, I would say x of t is always 1 for mod of t less than 1. But mod of t should be replaced with minus t. So minus t should be less than 1. So multiplying both sides by minus 1, I can rewrite this as t greater than minus 1. So again, x of t is 1 for t greater than minus 1. Now you have to observe only these two things. So you have to only see when x of t is 1, x of t is 1 when t less than 1. Is that right? Or x of t is 1 when t is greater than minus 1. And otherwise, it is 0. Because it is 0, otherwise, am I right? So only concentrate on two things. X of t equal to 1 for t less than 1 and x of t equal to 1 when t greater than minus 1. So here, if I take a t scale, I'll take 0 here, I'll take 1 here, I'll take minus 1 here. Is that right? So see to it. What is happening? For t less than 1, x of t is 1. And for t greater than minus 1, x of t is 1. So x of t is 1 between minus 1 to plus 1. I hope this is now quite clear to you. So in a way, they have provided us a rectangular function. Am I right? X of t is a rectangular function which has value equal to plus 1 between minus 1 to 1. Otherwise, it is 0. So it is straight away a rectangular function. So this is also a way by which they can express a rectangular function. Only thing is, you should understand how to decode the meaning of mod of t. So finally, x of t is known to me from minus 1 to plus 1, it is 1. Am I right? So you know what they are asking you for? They are asking you to have a convolution of x of 2t with x of t by 2. Now try to get x of 2t. So I'm sure you remember how to get x of 2t. So x of 2t, how do we get from x of t? Of course, when they are asking you to multiply by 2, we divide by 2, lower limit and upper limit. So it becomes like this, from minus half to half, and height of the rectangle remains same. So this is a rectangular function, which is x of 2t. So now you have to tell me, how do we represent it mathematically in terms of a rectangular function? So if you remember, it is like this, a rect of t by capital T, where t is a complete width of the triangle, where t is a complete width of the rectangle and a is height. So height is 1. So this is rect of t by. So if you see, the total width is 1. So it is just a rect of t. Suppose if I want to express x of t by 2, then when they are asking you to divide t by 2, you multiply by 2 to lower limit and upper limit. So lower limit and upper limit, when multiplied by 2, it becomes time expansion. In first case, it was time compression. So from minus 2 to 2 with height equal to 1. So now you can write this as rectangular of t by. Now you have to write a complete width. So if you see, complete width is 4. Is that right? So now tell me, when they are telling you to convolve x of 2t with x of t by 2, it means you are convolving these two rectangles. Am I right? After convolving these two rectangles, you're supposed to get some function and it would be one of the given options. Am I right? So let us see what is the convolution for this. First of all, I'll check a Fourier transform for the first signal. You know that every rectangular function after Fourier transform becomes a sampling function. A sampling function which is a function of omega. The maximum amplitude and a coefficient of omega needs to get calculated. So maximum amplitude of the sampling function is simply area of the given rectangle, am I right? So area for first rectangle is nothing but 1. And how do we get it? Simply by formula L into B, that is length into breadth. So if you see, what is the length? It is 1. What is the breadth? It is again 1. So I can say it is 1 over here. And coefficient of omega is nothing but half of width of the complete rectangle. So if you see a total width, it is 1. So half of it is 1 by 2. Am I right? Or I can write as sampling function of omega by 2. So this is a Fourier transform for x of 2t. Then I'll see a Fourier transform for x of t by 2. That is, it is rect of t by 4. So its Fourier transform is again a sampling function, which is function of omega. So here I have to write area of the rectangle. So if you see area of the rectangle, so it is L equal to 4 and B equal to 1. So area becomes 4. And coefficient of omega is nothing but half of the width of the given rectangle. So the given rectangle is having a width equal to 4. Half of it is 2. So finally it is 4 sampling function of twice of omega. Alright. So here I have to take a convolution of x of 2t with x of t by 2. We know that convolution in time domain is multiplication in frequency domain. So why do I have decided to take a Fourier transform? Just because if you see all the options, they are all of them in terms of omega. So of course, when the things are given in time domain and if options are given in frequency domain, naturally we have to go for a Fourier transform. Am I right? So here I have to now multiply these two, because convolution in time domain is multiplication in frequency domain. So what do we have? That is, first function is sampling of omega by 2. The another one is 4 sampling of 2 omega. I can rewrite this as, you know that a sampling theta is sine theta by theta. So I can rewrite this as sine of omega by 2 divided by omega by 2 multiplied by 4. Sine of omega can be written as, sampling of omega can be written as sine omega upon omega. So this 4 I have taken out. In denominator we have omega here. Here also we have omega. Omega into omega becomes omega square. Then what is remaining? It is sine of 2 omega upon 2 multiplied by sine of omega by 2 divided by 1 by 2. So here even 2 gets cancelled. And final answer I can write 4 by omega square sine of 2 omega multiplied by sine of omega by 2. So now we will see our options and we will take a correct option. So if you see, it is option number A. So option number A is the correct answer. So this is how we solve the problem. So in this, the only conceptual thing that we have seen, how to interpret the meaning of mod of t. Because if you don't understand the meaning of mod of t, you will never know that you will get a rectangular function out of it. Because if the rectangular function would have given directly to you, you could have solved this problem very easily, because this is something that we know in advance. Am I right? The only thing that what we were not knowing or what was new for us, that is a mod of t. So there are a lot of concepts in mathematics that you should know. If you know them, then it becomes quite easy to do application of the mathematics, like signal sense systems, control systems, or electrical network, in fact, and so on. Let's move ahead. So the next question says, x of t is rectangular function of t by minus half, where rect x is 1 for the interval from minus 1 by 2 to 1 by 2 and 0 otherwise. Then if sinc of x is sine pi x upon pi x, the Fourier transform for x of t plus x of minus t will be given by. So this is a gate 2008 problem. So don't get confused. What I'm just trying to tell you, identify what is x of t. I repeat, identify just what is x of t. Then just do the summation of x of t plus x of minus t, and you have to get a Fourier transform of it. We know by property, for x of t, Fourier transform is x of omega. And for x of minus t, Fourier transform is x of minus omega. This is by using a property called as a time reversal property. So let me tell you, if you identify what is x of t, it is just you have to perform addition of x of omega with x of minus omega and you have to get the final answer. Am I right? So it is that easy. The only trick is to identify x of t. And of course, x of t is given. So what is x of t? x of t is rect of t minus half. Am I right? And they have given you a rect of x. Okay. So they are saying that x is what? X is an independent variable. But generally, you know what? We are using independent variable as time. Even our problem demands that use a rectangular variable as t and not as x. So I'm doing only one thing. I'm just replacing this x with t. And you should not have any problem with this, am I right? So look at the rectangular function given. A rect of t is 1 between minus half to half. In fact, from the given function also, it is quite clear that a is equal to 1 and total width is also 1. It means it will be a function like this. That is, from minus half to half, it is 1. So this is a rectangular function, am I right? So this is a normal rectangular function. What I want is x of t, which is nothing but the original function rect of t. Only thing is t is replaced with t minus half. And I'm sure this is, you know, something called as a time shifting property. By using a time shifting property, I'll get x of omega. But then let me get back to my original function is rect of t. So tell me, for rect of t, how do we get a Fourier transform? Easy. A Fourier transform is a sampling function and it is a function of omega. The maximum amplitude of sampling function is nothing but area of the given rectangle. So if you see a graphical representation of this, it is from minus half to half with height equal to 1. So what is the area of this? Of course, it is 1. And what is the half width? It is nothing but half. So I would say a rectangular function rect of t has a Fourier transform equal to a sampling function of omega by 2. Is that right? And now you know what? X of t is nothing but a rect of t minus half. And now you have to get a Fourier transform for this. So let me remind you, what was the time shifting property? Time shifting property says, for given function x of t, if you have a Fourier transform as x of omega, then for x of t minus t naught, a Fourier transform, again, you are using x of omega only you are multiplying with e to the power minus j omega t naught x of omega. See, it is simple. So tell me, after having a Fourier transform for this, it will be same as that of x of omega, that is sampling of omega by 2. Only thing is, it is multiplied with e to the power minus j omega by 2. Because here, value of t naught is half. And you know that whenever you have a negative sign here, we have a negative sign in the exponent, that is in the power side. So if this is x of t, I would say this is x of omega. What they are asking you, a Fourier transform for x of t plus x of minus t. So now to get x of minus t, you know that a Fourier transform is simply x of minus omega. So wherever there is omega, in x of omega, replace omega with minus omega. So in that case, I'll get straight away e to the power positive j omega by 2, because we already have a negative sign here. When omega is replaced with minus omega, negative negative will become positive. So it is simply e to the power j omega by 2. It is sampling function of minus omega by 2. And if you know the rough structure of the sampling function, by observation, you should understand it is an even signal. And when I say signal is even, you know that x of minus t and x of t is same. Similarly, x of minus omega and x of omega would be same. What does that mean? That now I can rewrite this as e to the power j omega by 2. It is sampling of omega by 2. So this becomes a Fourier transform for x of minus t. So on conclusion side, I would say this one is a Fourier transform for x of t. And now what you got is a Fourier transform for x of minus t. and we have to take a Fourier transform of x of t plus x of minus t. So what I want is Fourier transform for x of t plus x of minus t. It's simply x of omega plus x of minus omega. So we already have the answer. For x of omega, this is your x of omega, and this is your x of minus omega. Am I right? So x of omega is e to the power minus j omega by 2 sampling function of omega by 2 plus x of minus omega is e to the power j omega by 2 sampling of omega by 2. So now if I take sampling omega by 2 common, what remains inside is e to the power j omega by 2 plus e to the power minus j omega by 2, and outside we have sampling function of omega by 2. Is that right? So you should know this e to the power j theta plus e to the power minus j theta is twice of cos of theta. So I can write this as twice of cos of omega by 2, and you know that sampling of theta is sine theta by theta, so it is sine of omega by 2 divided by omega by 2. So let us see our options. So if you see, all of them are given in terms of sinc and not in terms of a sampling function, am I right? So I can rewrite this as twice of cos of omega by 2. As you can see, I have kept the first term same. You know, this is nothing but your sampling function. And how do we express sampling function as sinc function? Just divide theta of sampling function by pi. So let me remind you, let's say if you have a sinc theta, it is simply sampling theta by pi. Am I right? So if you want to express sampling function in terms of sinc, just replace theta of the sampling function by theta by pi. So this sampling of omega by 2 will become sinc of omega upon 2 pi. Am I right? Now compare the options. So it is twice of sinc of omega by 2 pi into cos of omega by 2, which is option C. So option C is the correct option. So I'm sure you have understood what we have done. See, let me remind you what we have done. This was a given rectangular function, am I right? Which is 1 between minus 1 by 2 to 1 by 2. Then they were claiming that x of t is rect of t minus half. So we know that how to take a Fourier transform for rect function. So we did that. After that, we wanted to have x of omega. Am I right? How do we get x of omega? It is nothing but a Fourier transform of x of t. But if you see x of t, it is nothing but rectangular function with a time shifting of minus half. Am I right? So we have used a time shifting property, and accordingly we got x of omega. So what they wanted to have is a Fourier transform of x of t plus x of minus t, which is nothing but x of omega plus x of minus omega. From x of omega, we got x of minus omega by replacing omega equal to minus omega. Then we just did the addition and we got the final answer. So it was that simple. The only thing is you should know properties of Fourier transform. So now we are moving to one more important property called as a time integration property. Let us understand what is meant by a time integration property. Suppose we have signal x of t whose Fourier transform is known to me as x of omega. Time integration property is going to tell you, what if you integrate x of t? You know very well, x of t would be integrated if we pass x of t signal through integrator, am I right? And a standard integrator does a standard integration, and the standard integration, it's something which has lower limit as minus infinity, upper limit as t. So x of t is integrated this way. It is integration of x of tau with d tau, with lower limit as minus infinity and upper limit is t. We'll have a Fourier transform as x of omega upon j omega plus pi times x of 0 del of omega. So this is the property of a time integration property. Now the question is, how do we really remember this? Let me tell you, you are not going to remember this. There are two reasons behind it. First, this property is not that important from Git point of view. And second, you don't have to remember this because you can easily derive this. Now the question is how to derive this. So this is where I'm going to help you out. To make you understand it in a better way, I'm sure you must have seen all the lectures in sequence, because I keep saying that sequence is very, very important. Every time when I'm discussing something, it has already explained in some previous to previous lectures. Like here, I'm going to tell you the concept that I have already taught you during LTI system, that is during convolution. So I told you, whenever you convolve x of t with a unit step function, that is u of t, it is as good as integrating your x of t. So this is always equivalent to integrating x of t. So please remember, whenever you convolve x of t with, let's say, a del function del of t, it is x of t itself, am I right? So this is, we have already learned during convolution. So whenever you are convolving the given signal x of t with delta function, it is the function itself, but that is not the same when you convolve with u of t. So convolving the given function x of t with u of t means integrating x of t. So I'm sure now you got it. What does that mean? This whole integration, that is integrating your x of t from lower limit minus infinity to t, is as good as, can I say that it is x of t convolving the u of t, right? And again, still we are in time domain only, okay? We are still in time domain only. The only thing is, I have represented this integration of x of t in the other way out, okay? That is x of t convolved with u of t. You know that after having a Fourier transform, convolution becomes multiplication. So x of t would be x of omega multiplied by, it is Fourier transform of u of t. So it is again x of omega multiplied by, you know, what is a Fourier transform for u of t? A Fourier transform for u of t, this is also we have already derived, which is 1 upon j omega plus pi times del of omega. So let us expand this. Now this x of omega will get multiplied with the two terms over here. So it becomes x of omega upon j omega plus x of omega multiplied with pi del of omega. We know that a product property with any impulse function, okay? So del of omega is impulse function present at omega equal to 0. So what we do is we substitute omega equal to 0 here. So it becomes x of 0. Finally, what I can write is x of omega by j omega plus, so I'm writing this pi first, then x of omega becomes x of 0, and this del function also remains there. So this is a final answer. That is a final Fourier transform. So I'm telling you, you don't have to really remember this. Whenever you will come across this time integration property, which is a very, very rare case, in that case, as I told you, you don't have to remember the final result, because there are two reasons. The very first and important reason is this is not that important from Git point of view. And secondly, you can derive it very easily. So I repeat what I said over here. When I say x of t is having a Fourier transform as x of omega, then integration of x of t is as good as x of t convolving with u of t. And x of t convolving with u of t as a Fourier transform equal to x of omega multiplied by u of omega. What is u of omega? It is a Fourier transform of u of t. We know that convolution in time domain becomes product in frequency domain. So x of omega as it is multiplied by Fourier transform of u of t, I have expanded this way. And just by again taking this x of omega into bracket, you will get this as final result. So you have to only remember this as final result. And in case if you are not able to remember this, you can derive it very easily within a half minute, I would say. Thank you.